I have a question for all of you before I start. If you had to paint a picture of you in a crisis, when you were really, really scared, you in a crisis when you were really, really scared, how best would you represent that picture? What metaphorical representation suits you best in that stage? Think about it. You can answer me after the story as well. This is a story of me having discovered my metaphor for being in a crisis. It was 4 p.m. on a Sunday in April 2010. I was in that blissful state between awake and almost asleep. Most of you must have been in that state. It's a brilliant state. On my couch in the hall of my apartment in Nungambakkam, Chennai. The large windows were open. The curtains were dancing with a summer breeze, and I could just barely discern the noise of young boys playing cricket outside. Pure bliss. And that's when I heard it. A strange sound coming from the adjacent room. I trembled, shivered despite the heat. My breathing began to get shallow. My stomach started clenching. All forebodings of an all-familiar panic. I slowly got up, gathered a few things, and stepped outside my house, just half closing the door. I was in a crisis. I instinctively knew I had to call him, Abhijit. Abhi is a sweetheart and he's really, really brave. I knew he'd help and I knew he'd know what to do. Hello? Abhi, can you come to my apartment right now, please? What happened? Are you all right? No, I'm not. I'm terrified. I sounded so scared on the phone that he didn't even check what it was, but he left immediately. And within 10 minutes, he was there. Abhi found me standing outside my apartment in my polka dotted pajamas, holding a sword and shield, my sword and shield, a broom in one hand and a very large bucket lid in the other hand. What happened? Is someone inside? Yes, obviously. Take a look. Looking at me all terrified, Abhi ran back to his car and got a large steel rod. We walked further in, closer to the source of the menace. And then we heard it again, that god-awful noise. Abhi stopped abruptly. Everything stood still for a moment. And then Abhi turned angrily and screamed at me. A pigeon? You called me here in such a hurry because a pigeon was in your house? Sadly, Abhi neither thought it was funny nor scary. He did chase the pigeon away, thankfully, but he was so mad at me that he did not speak to me at all for a while. He was mad, but I was grateful, so grateful. I am terrified of flapping pigeons. I simply can't stand it. And it's not just pigeons. I can't stand flapping hens, chickens, and pheasants either. Something happens to me when they flap their wings like that. And when I hear them, some tremor goes through my body. I don't know what it is. I have never seen a peacock flap its wings, but I'm sure if it did, that would freak me out as well. In college, I studied psychology. And in my second year, we read about Alfred Adler. And he said, when faced with a crisis, human beings respond in one of the following three ways. One, they run away from the crisis. Two, they pretend like everything is fine and face the crisis. Or three, they try and attack the source of fear back. Most of you must have heard this. It's called the fight or flight response. Of course, in the modern world, it should ideally be the fight, flight or vodka response. But you get the point. Most of us have unique coping mechanisms when you are in a crisis, right? I'm sure you might think about your coping mechanism when you are in a crisis. Mine is usually what I call the damsel mode. I unabashedly call somebody for help. And with years of practice, I am very good at knowing the exact right person to call for help in a particular situation. It's a skill. It's an art. Though I did know who to call when the pigeon attack happened, I have no idea why the flapping pigeon scared me so much. So my mom often tells me the story about why she thinks I'm so scared of these birds, especially hens. According to her, this is her story. Apparently, when I was a toddler once, I was standing at my grandfather's balcony in Madurai. We had just come back from Tirupati, and obviously, I was sporting the Tirupati hairstyle. So, a hen in a coop nearby must have mistaken my head for its own unhatched egg. I'm sure a very genuine mistake to make, and it sailed to sit on it. It wouldn't fly off, and I was crying really loudly till my parents came and they pushed the hen off my head. My mum recounts the story of my trauma to pretty much everyone she meets, you know, in the family. Yeah, it's so hilarious, right? So this is it, according to her. This is why I'm scared. But I have never been so sure. And anyway, fear is fear. It doesn't understand reasonable and unreasonable. A couple of days after the pigeon incident, me, Abhi, who had finally forgiven me after the many apologies that I gave him, and a couple of other friends, formed a study group and met at this brilliant beach house near the beach, Besanagar Beach, if you've heard of it, in Chennai. So after studying, after a full day of reading over the coursework, we decided to go and sit by the beachside. Being a weekday, the beach was pretty quiet. And for hours, we just sat there gossiping and enjoying the salty breeze at the end of a hot summer day. The waves were making their all reassuring, "It's all okay, it's all okay, it's all okay" noise. Right? And that's one of the most soothing, That's one of the most soothing sounds to me in the world. And we were all feeling really relaxed. Slowly, most of our group started drifting around. Some of them decided to take a walk. And before long, I found myself sitting there alone with just one another friend called Anusha. Gradually, she and I also stopped chatting. And we were just sitting quietly, listening to music with headphones on. And I was listening, I was thinking thoughts about the break after exams, travel, elusive knights in shining armor, you know, natural stuff. All of a sudden, I heard it again. The sound of loud pop music, not the pigeon sound. A jeep was standing nearby with a bunch of guys. I could see their eyes through the windshield and they were red and glazed over. They were revving their engine and playing Michael Jackson loud enough to wake his ghost. This sound drowned the waves of the comforting waves. Round the sound of the comforting waves. All was not okay. I tried to ignore it, but then all of a sudden, one of these guys stumbles really close to us, throws something between right between where we were sitting, and both of us look at it confused, Anusha and I. And my friend Anusha, she picked it up with curiosity, and she found it was a credit card with a paper wrapped around it, which said, "Hey, pretty women, care to have a good time?" on the credit card. I'm struggling to use the one word, you know, as how to describe this. Humiliation, rage, unfairness, fear. I guess one word wouldn't suffice. I just got up and I shouted at those guys incoherently, and my words tumbling over one another. This only had the response of laughter from those guys and "let's get out of here" from Anusha. She dragged me and I followed her. But not before I gave those idiots another piece of my mind. I guess fear and rage do hamper decision-making skills to a great extent. So after having said goodbye to my friends, I made the first mistake. I decided to board a bus to drop me home, all alone. It was about 9 p.m. I was ruminating over my feelings of disgust and rage at what had just happened. And the adrenaline pumping in me had made me reckless, almost. The bus dropped me off about 2 kilometers away from my apartment, which was located in a secluded and quiet area of the city, and I started walking home. As I walked, I was lost in my thoughts, wondering whether we had covered everything that was going on in the test and all of that. As I was walking along, again, I heard something. It was the same Michael Jackson song, as loud as it could be played. And I turned around, and it was the very same Jeep with the very same 4 guys on that small road. And to my horror, I realized that there was no one on the road apart from me and those guys. The small hairs on the back of my neck stood up completely straight, and I started sprinting towards my house. The Jeep pulled up right next to me, and in the span of about 2 seconds, the door clicked open and a hand shot out of it, grabbing at my blouse and almost pulling me in. I jumped back and I screamed. The hand let go to a raucous peal of laughter from inside. I fell into the nearby bushes and I scratched myself and I ran again. My arms were cut and bleeding now. The jeep came close to me and stood next to me again, blocking my way. The door opened, and a man was sitting on the edge of the seat in the back looking at me, his hand stretching out, barely missing me. My entire body shivered. I jumped again, almost falling into a ditch this time. The man again pulled his hand back, and there was a lot more laughter. This episode, thinking about it is giving me goosebumps. This episode continued a few more times on the road. To them, it was a game. They were predators and I was the prey. They enjoyed my flight of helplessness, reacting in panic to their every move. I was in a crisis yet again. Then my defense mechanism kicked in. Out of the sideline of my vision, I could see the building that was closest to me, about 500 meters from mine. A friend of mine called Jyoti used to live there, and I'd been there before. And my weird skill of remembering the very person I needed to call for help flashed the friendly face and the name of the watchman who must be around here somewhere. Muthu Anna! I screamed. For 20 seconds, everything stood still. And then I breathed again as I heard footsteps running outside and taking in the scene, shouting loudly. The jeep sped before I could note its license number down. Relief swept along with nausea. Amidst the retching and my insane heartbeat, my fluttering slowly came to a stop. This has to be one of the most scariest nights of my entire life. It haunted me for many, many days. A couple of days after this incident, I was standing in the balcony of my house when a pigeon sat on the railing. I tried to keep still and just willed myself to stand there and not be afraid. Just a pigeon, just a pigeon, just a pigeon, I chanted, and I was fine, no fear. Then the pigeon flew from my balcony to the next. And with the flutter of its wings in the pigeon, in that moment, I felt a jolt in my stomach and my panic rise. She narrowly escaped her predator, just like I had. With the suddenness that only realizations can bring, I realized it's not the bird that scares me. It's not the bird's wings, nor the chaos of its flappings. It's the sheer feeling of helplessness that the act represents. It's the panic and confusion and all of those feelings which are kind of exploding into the bird's wings at that point. When I see it, I feel it, and that strikes some kind of primal terror inside of me. Something very deep about what it means truly to be alone, to be afraid, and to not be sure where to go. It's the same feeling that came up to me that day in the jeep, when the jeep was chasing me. The bird helplessly flapping its wings, it's the perfect metaphor for how I feel when I am in a panic mode. When something's coming at me that's too large for my system to handle. And of course, like most people, I fear itself. So look inside of yourself. Think about what you fear and how you feel when you're afraid. What's your metaphor for it? It may teach you a lot more than you know. Thank you.